Welcome to our Yorkshire online broadcast. We're delighted that you've tuned in. It's Pentecost weekend. It's our opportunity to celebrate the birth of the church, the coming of the Holy Spirit, to empower the church to be and to do everything that Jesus did and more, because there's more of us. We're going to be talking about Pentecost today and what God has yet in store for those who choose to put their trust in Him and to follow Him. We're going to see a victory, even in times of crisis like this.
have I been changed? This is a question that we as followers of Jesus need to ask ourselves and answer honestly. How have I been changed since becoming a follower of Jesus? How am I different than before? How is my life different than those of my friends and neighbors who aren't believers? And maybe you are listening and you're not a follower of Jesus. And you look at your life and you realize that maybe something does need to be different. These are important questions, and the Apostle Paul asks them in the book of Philippians. He starts by asking, have you been changed? Have you experienced these things? Do you exhibit these characteristics? Because if so, then you are called to have the mind of Christ, to have the same attitude as Jesus. As I read the passage today, I want you to listen for what it is that Paul is calling us to. What does it mean to look like Jesus? What does it mean to have the attitude of Christ? I read now from Philippians 2. Have you had any encouragement from being united with Christ? Have you had any comfort from his love? Any fellowship with the Spirit? Have you had any tenderness or compassion? If so, then make my joy complete by being like-minded and having the same love, being one in spirit and purpose. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourselves. Each of you should look not only to your own interests, but also to the interests of others. Your attitude should be the same as that of Jesus Christ, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant. Being made in human likeness and being found in the appearance of man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen.
I wish. Have you ever made a wish? Well, of course you have. We've all made wishes. As a matter of fact, we've created rules and systems for wish making. Just think about that for a moment with me. I mean, we know how to wish and when to wish, and even what to wish for and not wish for. Think about that moment right before you blow out your birthday candles, or that moment when you see the first star in the sky at night. What do you do? Well, then there's that whole thing when you're driving. If you're driving over a railroad tracks and there's a train passing underneath, you pick up your feet, or vice versa. If you're going under a train that's on a bridge over your highway, you duck your head. Hopefully you're not doing that while you're driving. But it's part of wish-making. And then there's that breaking the wishbone and throwing coins in the fountains. We have all kinds of things surrounding wish-making. Of course, wish-making has its drawbacks, too. You've heard the old saying, be careful what you wish for, you just might get it. It may not be what you thought it would be. There's just something captivating about wish-making. Now, experts who study such things as wish-making say that wishes are usually motivated by one of two things. The first is frustration. I wish this coronavirus would go away. The second is opportunity. I wish I had a chance to do that. These same experts who study these things say you can learn a lot from people and about people according to the things they wish for. You can tell things they value, the things that are important to them. Well, that's true in businesses as well, and certainly it's true about the church. May I ask you a question this morning? What's your wish today? My time as interim pastor of Yorkshire Church is soon completed. In a few weeks, we're going to welcome a new pastor, Dave Kaminsky. But before that takes place, and as I complete this year and this time among the people at Yorkshire Church and you online, I want to share on this Pentecost Day just a few things that I wish for about the church, and in particular, this congregation that is Yorkshire Church. I wish that our East York community was glad that Yorkshire Church was here. I wish they were glad that we were here and that they'd miss us if we weren't. You know, the wisdom of the Bible says the whole community celebrates when the godly succeed. The whole community celebrates when the godly succeed. What that means, I think, is that the community is excited and is joyful when things are going well at the church. And why? Because there are those within that church who know the joy of Jesus and the peace that passes understanding that only Jesus gives and the world can't take away. There's a hope that's found in knowing Jesus and following Jesus and living in His way. Knowing who we are and whose we are as followers of Jesus is contagious. And for a community to know and to see followers of Jesus living out what Jesus was doing, loving God, loving others, serving God and serving others, well, the whole community becomes a beneficiary and is blessed by that kind of activity. You see, the whole community does celebrate when the godly succeed. Think about what it would look like if this congregation would fulfill with joy and hope the commands of Jesus to love others, to serve others. What would it be like if we lived in such a way knowing that Jesus was alive, that He was with us, that He was working His will and His way out through us? Oh, it might be just like that first day of Pentecost in Acts 2. When non-believers looked at those who were followers of Jesus and they saw how much they loved each other, they saw the passion of that love and their desire for the best in others and for the community, that they wanted to be a part of it. You know, it's sort of like that old sitcom, Cheers, and their theme song. Do you remember it? Some of you who are old enough. It was a place you wanted to be because everyone knew your name. Everyone cared about you. Do you want to be a part of that kind of church? Could we be that kind of church where the community celebrates because of our success of living Jesus' way? What would it be like if our entire community celebrated and enjoyed their life together in a greater degree because followers of Jesus were fanning out from worship to the places where they work and play and go to school, to share the love of Jesus and to live God's way with others? I think lives would be changed. Relationships would be healed. Lives in our community would begin to reflect the ways that God would have us live in peace and harmony with one another, respecting one another, caring for one another, encouraging one another, lifting one another up, learning from our mistakes, sharing our victories. Do you think others would want to be a part of a community of faith like that? Could we be that kind of church? What do you wish, and what is your wish for the church of Jesus Christ? Well, that first day of Pentecost, when Jesus established the church, there was this unique assembly of people, just 11 guys. But all followers of Jesus who were ignited by a contagious faith and hope found only in Jesus. And the result in just that first day was 3,000 more people became followers of Jesus because they wanted to be a part of the joy, that community that loved others like that. The community celebrates when the godly succeed. Oh, I wish our East York community was glad that we, as Yorkshire Church, are who God wants us to be, and that we're doing exactly what God has equipped us to do and wants us to be doing. What that would mean is that our neighbors would know we're for them. We're for them, their families, their marriages, their home, their children, their schools, their jobs, their life together. It would mean that we as followers of Jesus, in our ongoing daily relationships at the grocery store and at the gas station, would be unafraid to be with people and to talk about the things that are important to them. And among those things, to be willing to talk about God and to share, talk about Jesus and the way that He has for us to live lives better than what we do without Him. We would be a people who would be helping others in their relationships, to grow in their relationship with Jesus and with others. We'd be pursuing values that are different than our cultures. We'd be pursuing life and not death. We'd be more forgiving, finding ways to forgive others. We'd be making neighbors and friends' wishes come true as well. Listen very carefully, you may not know this, but your neighbors and your friends who know that you know Jesus and that you love Jesus and that He's made a difference in your life, they wish that you would take time to tell them, your friends, your neighbors, about this Jesus. They wish you'd talk to Jesus about Jesus with them. Make room to answer their questions about Jesus and discover for themselves the way and the truth and life found only in Jesus. It's true. Let me give you some real numbers. According to the most recent demographic information in our area, 66% of the people living next door to you and me, right here in our community, say they have either no faith at all or that they have minimal, moderate faith involvement. And here's the fact that ought to stop us in our tracks. 80% of this 60%, 66%, excuse me, of our neighbors who say they have little or no involvement in the church, 80% of them say they would choose to attend a church if someone they knew invited them. That's you. That's your opportunity to invite someone to come and to connect with, engage the person who's made so much difference in your life, and that's Jesus. I know we're not the only church in this zip code, but let me challenge you as your church, as followers of Jesus in this community, who want to make the community glad because of our success in following Jesus' way. What if we set our sights in this next year on reaching 1,000 people in our community who right now are not yet part of any faith community at all? What if we made it a goal in this next year to reach 1,000 people and plant seeds of faith and hope that are only found in Jesus into their lives? Again, 1,000 people who are living right here in our community, our neighbors, our friends. What might happen? Oh, this is more than a wish. It's a goal that's bigger than your church. 1,000 people? Can you imagine it? We don't have enough parking or space for 1,000 people to come and sit in our building. But that's not the point, and that's really not our purpose. Our ministry is about enabling people to grow in their relationship with Jesus. Our purpose, our mission and ministry as a church is for our community to be glad because the ways of God are finding success in the life of the community as a whole. But here's the thing. If that's the wish that you might share with me today, it's not going to happen unless all of us choose to get involved. Unless all of us choose in our own way, as God leads us, to take some risk and choose to be at work where God is at work, to connect, to engage, to talk with people around us who God's already talking to about the things in life that really matter. You know, I'm not the first one to have this kind of a wish. Long ago, there was a man by the name of Paul. perhaps a goat, the greatest of all time, when it comes to followers of Jesus makers and church planters. Paul knew what it took to reach people for Jesus and to bring them in as a part of a church where people belong before they ever believe. Paul wrote letters of encouragement and expressed not only his love for them, but also his wish for them. This is what Paul wrote in his letter. "I'm sure that God, who began a great work in you, will continue until it's finished on that day when Jesus Christ comes back. I live in eager anticipation and hope that my life will always honor Jesus." Paul goes on to say, "Is there any encouragement, any benefit, any joy in belonging to Jesus and his church? Is there any comfort to be received from his love? Is there anything that's genuine or authentic or exciting or real about having a relationship with Jesus, a connection with God through his Holy Spirit and with God's household, his assembly of people, that's the church?" Now here it is. Listen very carefully. Here's Paul's wish. "Do you want to make me really happy?" This is what he wrote. "Do you want to make my joy complete? Then I wish you would agree wholeheartedly with one another. I wish that you would love each other. I wish that you would work together with one heart for one purpose, that others might know the love of God and love one another too." Did you hear that? Wholehearted agreement. Oh, that's not uniformity. Unity is never uniformity. There's lots of things we'll never agree on, but there are things that are important that we need to agree on, things that really matter. And when we can agree on those things wholeheartedly, we can be the people God wants us to be, who love one another, who work together for one purpose, and that is that the whole community might rejoice and be glad because God's will and God's way within God's people is succeeding. Now, if you're wondering how that could ever happen, Paul doesn't disappoint in the letter. He continues to write and answers that how question. He says, "Don't be selfish. Don't live to make a good impression on other people." You know, you can make followers of Jesus and grow a church anywhere, in any kind of a building or without a building, online or offline, without the best lights or media presentations or music. Paul did it, and it's still being done today. But here's the key. If you're going to build a community of faith, you've got to be authentic with people. You've got to be the real deal. Me first living. It's all about me and the things that I want. Let's talk about you and what do you think about me kind of attitude always gives the church and Christians a bad name, a bad reputation, and it drives people away. Being a follower of Jesus is never about us, about you, about me. It's about Jesus and what he has done and what he promises to do. He never breaks his promises, and the hope that is ours that reaches into the hearts and the minds of those who are seeking hope and a peace that the world just can't take away, especially in times like these. Be authentic. It means be focused on Jesus. And then Paul says, be humble. Think about others. Boy, that's countercultural, isn't it? The world doesn't revolve around you or me. I know that's a hard thing to hear, but it's true. Vain conceit isn't good for you, it's not good for me, it's not good for Jesus, it's not good for the church. Remember, JOY is an acronym. Jesus, others, yourself. That's what it looks like. And that's the attitude Paul says we need to have as followers of Jesus. As a matter of fact, this is what he writes. Your attitude should be the same as Jesus. Though he was God, He didn't demand rights and privileges as if he was entitled because he was God. Instead, in human form, in other words, being in the same physical human being as we are, so that we could be just like him, Jesus obediently humbled himself, dying a criminal's death on a cross. And because of this, God raised himself up so that everyone who confesses him to be Lord of all might be lifted up for the glory of God. Do you hear the wish, the hope, that others might come to know the joy and the love of God and be a part of the community that serves God, growing in faith, living by hope, and trust in Jesus? Can we be that kind of church? Can we do that? Would it make a difference in our community? Would the community be glad if we were succeeding in these things? God is calling for a new Yorkshire church to emerge with a new pastor in the next month. God is calling a new Yorkshire church to be a mission station in this community. And he's calling the people who are Yorkshire Church to be its missionaries. Our purpose is greater than us. It's greater than redistributing collected money and goods. It's greater than being nice and doing nice things. Our purpose is to connect with people who are not yet connected with Jesus. Why? Because that's what God did. Other religions in the world, here's the difference. Other religions in the world always try to have people do things to be good enough to get to God. But Christian faith, our God loved us so much that he came to find us, came to find you and me, so that we might have life at its best now and forever. I want to be a part of that kind of a church. Don't you? A church that is succeeding in God's will and God's way. And for that, the community is glad. Can we be that church? Let me close by asking just three questions very quickly. Who do you know that's difficult? They're just a difficult person to be around. What if you chose to love that person like Jesus? To value them, to care for them, not because they maybe earned it or deserve it, but simply because Jesus does. As you get to know that person, here's the second question. Do you know what they wish for? Do you know their hopes and their dreams? What would make their joy complete? Are you willing to find out? And are you willing to do something about it? And thirdly, here's this question. How can we be as generous to that difficult person as Jesus has been to us, who've been sometimes very difficult? Here's my wish for you, for Yorkshire Church on this Pentecost day. I wish that our whole community was glad that we're here, and that they would know and rejoice in the fact that we're here for them. What's your wish? Holy Spirit of God, come among us. Come among us. Empower us to be your church once again. Amen. Hey, thank you for joining us in our Yorkshire broadcast online. We're glad that you did. We hope you've been blessed. We'd sure like to hear from you. Take time, if you will, maybe even right now or sometime through this week, to just drop us a line, email, text us, go online, contact us that way. We'd love to know how we can pray for you or maybe take that next step in belonging and becoming a part of the followers of Jesus Christ within the church. Our doors are always open to you online. We'll be here every week. And you need to know that as our world begins to open up again from this current pandemic crisis we've been in, our doors are open on Sunday mornings at 9 and 10:45, starting on June 7th. We'll be taking the necessary precautions in the days in which we live. But we hope, if you have the opportunity, come check us out live and in person. We'd be delighted to welcome you and see you here right through these doors.